Well, praise the Lord. Welcome to everybody today to our Founders Day. First time we've ever had Founders Day, and wasn't everybody here, and also Christmas and Easter, and I'll tell you, it's just been a very unusual year, very unusual. But we're glad we're going to have Phillips and Banks today with us, and Jacob be preaching for us, and we're looking for a good time in the Lord. But did want to make an announcement to you. As you know, we've been out since late October because the cases had got so high, and they're still high. But it's come to my knowledge that we're having some people that are having spiritual trouble, and it's rough on them. And we do not want that to be. In trying to protect someone's physical health, we do not want to damage someone's spiritual health. It wouldn't be the right thing to do. So next Sunday, we will be going back to services. Now, I want to repeat this and repeat it 2 or 3 times to you. If you're having trouble and you need to come, then we want you to do so. But if you're getting along just fine at the house on YouTube, you're not, you know, there's no pressure whatsoever. We do not want to do that. It wouldn't be the right thing to do, and we're not going to do. That's how I try my best to live my life, is by what I think is right. And it would not be the right thing for me to do to pressure you, and I'm not going to. And I want you to feel free. You will get a one call sometime this next week. And it'll say press 1 if you're planning to come to service this next Sunday, and press 2 if you're going to stay home and watch it on YouTube or the DVDs that I deliver to those that don't have internet. And again, no pressure whatsoever. And then you will receive a one call back telling you what service to go to, whether we need one service or whether we need 2, you know. And I do want to repeat again, there is no pressure whatsoever. If you're doing fine spiritually at the house, watching it on YouTube and DVD, and you feel safe, then that's what we want you to do. But if you're having struggle, if you're struggling, we also want to be here for you. So we want to let you know that. Again, we're looking for a good time of the Lord. Let us go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll let Phillips and Banks come and sing for you. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, and your grace, Lord. Father, we ask you to reach down your hand from heaven, bless all those that are sick and afflicted. Lord, Brother Raymond and Sister Gilda and Dustin there is just diagnosed with COVID. And Lord, Father, we ask you today, touch Sister Lana Weaver. And Father, remember Sister Carolyn and Sister Linda and Sister Kathy, Lord, who lost a cousin and aunt. And God, Father, we just know today that you're the great I am. You're exactly, Lord, what we need you to be. And Father, we ask you to be everything to these today. And God, Father, we're just giving you the praise and the glory. And Lord, we ask it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing. When he said, thou be clean, I will praise him, I will praise him, praise the Lamb for sinners slain.
God's fire upon the altar.
cease to praise Him. Glory, glory to His name. I will praise Him. Sinners slain. Give Him glory, all ye people, for His blood can wash
guilty thoughts, my heart was aching, my back was breaking from the weight of all my sins that kept me far from Him. He knew full well the lonely death I'd earned, chose for Himself what I fully deserve. Thank God He took the one possession I could claim. The cross He carried was no longer mine. Praise His holy name. He took the cross, gave me life, and my life began. What He took from me made me richer like I've never been. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him.
Amen. I'm glad He set me free.
He always planned to take my place that day before time began. There was just one way. As He wept in the garden, His heart was wide open. All the love He felt for me made Him climb the Calvary. He took the cross, gave me life, and my life began. What He took from me made me richer like I've never been. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him.
He took the cross,
He took the cross, gave me life, and my life began.
What He took from me,
what He took from me, made me richer like I've never been. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him. Follow Him, follow Him.
Amen.
He took the cross.
He took the cross, gave me life, and my life began.
What He took from
me, made me richer like I've never been. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him. Instead of spending all my days buried beneath my sins, the cross He carried set me free to follow Him. Follow Him, follow Him.
Amen, amen.
It's so good to be here with you this morning on your Founders Day, and I know it's a little different, but that's okay, because this is the season of different, right? So anyway, it's really good to be here with you. It's good to be home, and I'm in your homes right now. Many of you who are watching by way of YouTube and all that good stuff, so it's kind of weird, but it's cool. So it's good to be with you. This next song that we're going to sing, we've about sung all of our songs here because, you know, we get to come and visit with you all at least once or twice a year. And so we thought we would do some songs that we don't do very often with you guys, or maybe we haven't done at all. And one of those songs is on our brand new recording that we just put out in summer of 2020. And it's called The Fight. And basically, it's just about the same God that we serve when we're on the mountaintop is the same God that we serve and love and cherish and are devoted to when we're walking through the deepest, darkest valleys. And I've said this for years, and I've heard it said for years, that the reason why, you know, when you're up on the mountaintop, everybody wants to be on the mountaintop, but when you're up on the mountaintop, if you'll notice, it's really cold up there, not a lot of vegetation grows up there, but it's down in the valley where everything is beautiful and lush, and it grows and it's green. And so sometimes we got to go through a valley, we got to go through a storm or a trial in order to grow. And that the same God that we serve on the mountaintop is the same God that we serve on the valley, in the valley. And Autumn wrote this song. We've never done it for y'all, so I hope you enjoy it tonight, or this morning. It's this morning, right?
A valley deep and wide, slowly moving step by step, but there's faith in every stride. Far in the distance I can see the promised land in view. No fear can overtake me, 'cause I know what God can do. The same God from the mountaintop is still God in the valley low. That same hand that led me high will lead me when the cold winds blow. There's gonna come a morning that'll never give way to the night. But until that day, Lord, come what may, I won't give up the fight.
I get a little taste of heaven when the Lord draws near to me.
God draws near to
my worries, fears, and questions disappear, and my sorrow cease.
When
my spirit's weary from the journey, He gives me strength to stand. And when my eyes can't see the path ahead, He
takes me by the hand. The same God from the mountaintop is still God in the valley low. That same hand that led me high will lead me when the cold winds blow. There's gonna come a morning that'll never give way to the night. But until that day, Lord, come what may, I won't give up the fight.
He's turning mountains into stepping stones. Through the valley of the shadow, He has never left me alone. That chilly Jordan, I'm going onward to my Lord. The same God from the mountaintop is still God in the valley low.
In the valley low.
That same hand that led me high will lead me when the cold winds blow.
There's gonna come a morning that'll never give way to the night. But until that day, Lord, come what may, I won't give up the fight. But until that day, Lord,
come what may, I won't
give up the fight.
I love that song. I hope everybody in their house right now is rocking. 'Cause it, I mean, it does. It pumps me up, and that's the truth. No matter what happens, what gets thrown at us, obviously there's been a lot of obstacles this year, but it doesn't matter. You know, something that the Lord has brought to my attention is, and he has to do it time and time again and be reminded. So I want to remind you that it doesn't matter what's going on in our government and anything. The point is, he's still God. He's still on the throne. And I've said that many times, and God had to remind me. So don't feel downtrodden if the Lord's had to say, hey, remember who I am in your life. Don't feel like that's you're all alone in that. That's not true. But that's the great thing about God. He's our Heavenly Father. And just like your dad has to remind you who dad is occasionally, God does the same thing with us as his children. And I love how he does it, because it's not in front of everyone all the time. Sometimes it happens that way. My dad used to whoop me. It didn't matter where it was at. But God gets you alone, and he takes you off to somewhere where you don't hear all the distractions that's around you. You don't hear all the other voices that's trying to tell you what God may be saying, or well, it could be this or it could be that. But God gets you alone with just him. And that's this next song we're going to do. I know it's going to be familiar to a lot of you, but I just pray that if just for the moment or however long this song is, just take a moment with you and God and just get in his presence, because that's where your answers, that's where your spiritual strength, your growth, all of those things happen. And be reminded of Psalm 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the wings. And I pray that that's what you're doing.
In and out of situations that tug of war in me all day long, I struggle for the answers that I need. Moment, no doubt can interfere in the presence of Jehovah, God Almighty. Give up in despair.
Father, we thank you that in your presence we can find everything we need, everything we want, for in your presence is fullness of joy. We are so grateful, Lord, for the opportunity that even though we may not be gathered together here in this building right now, Lord, because of the power of technology and the internet, and Lord, we can sit in our homes and we can enjoy your presence. You see, we don't have to wait on the next great sermon or the next great song. We can experience your presence anytime, anywhere, even in the comfort of our own homes. And so, Father, I just pray by the power of the Holy Spirit right now that you'll just sweep each home, Lord, that's listening right now. God, I pray for each person, each family that's represented here to in their homes today. God, I just pray that you'll encourage them, that you'll wrap your arms around them, God, that you'll remind them how much you love them and how much you want a relationship with them, an everyday relationship with them, God. Thank you, Lord, for this time of worship that we can have with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As we continue, this next song is off of our new project, and it's called Sweet Peace. There's a lot of songs about peace and hope and joy, and we hope you enjoy this one.
All around I feel the tempest as it batters my heart, with a trial that's taken its toll. And although it may seem life has fallen apart, down inside there is rest in my soul. For Jesus surrounds me with his strong arms of love, and he whispers that he'll never leave. Aren't you glad? No, it doesn't really matter if the sailing is rough, for even then there is peace, sweet peace. Not just when the winds are silent and the water is calm, not just when the sun is shining and the clouds are all gone, for I have blessed assurance in the midst of the storm, for there is peace, sweet peace, in the presence of the Lord.
Sing it, Caleb.
I've a captain who is leading through the wild, rugged waves, and my vessel is far from defeat. Oh, for I have settled safely 'neath the portals of grace, where the rain falls but cannot harm me.
When I'm shipwrecked inside from a current that refuses to cease, no, it doesn't really matter if I'm worn from the tide, for even then there is peace, sweet peace.
Listen, church.
Not just when the winds are silent and the water is calm, not just when the sun is shining and the clouds are all gone, for I have blessed assurance in the midst of the storm, for there is
is peace, sweet peace, in the presence of the Lord. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. I have blessed assurance in the midst of the storm, for there is peace, sweet peace, in the presence of the Lord. For there is peace, sweet peace, in the presence of the Lord.
Amen. Amen. I'm thankful for that peace. I'm thankful for that peace. Praise God. Praise God. I hope you know what brings that peace today.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than any houses or lands. I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hands than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to His dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to His holy name than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. Oh, I'd rather have You, Jesus, more than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have You, Jesus, more than
Father, thank You. You know, it's true. When we can take a moment and look at everything that we have and what we don't and things that we want or what we think we want or need. Lord, aside from you, there's nothing that we need. There's nothing that compares to you. And the crazy thing about that, Lord, is you want to share that with us. You want us to have that relationship, Lord, that fellowship with you that no one else can provide. And God, we give you glory for that. I pray, Lord, that we're reminded today, if nothing else, Lord, everything else seems crazy around us, or nothing else seems like we could have hope or thankfulness. May we be reminded, Lord, that you made a way for us to be a part of your family. You came and died for us, Lord, not the other way around. You are the one and only sacrifice that changed our lives forever. And we give you glory, Lord. Thank you for what you're going to do. I pray that you anoint Jacob today, Lord, and just preach him, Lord. Preach him all you want. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, before I start today, I just wanted to, say a special thank you to you all. I know that you guys have prayed for us over the last year, and we've been praying for the church, and I always try to keep up with everybody and what's going on through my dad and my mom, of course, and then I even get the one calls, so I know all your business. But it's always good to hear those reports, and dad comes on there nearly every day and sends a one call out, and I appreciate that because I know how to pray for people, and you all are my family, and I want you to know that I've been praying for you and for the church over the last year. I know it's been difficult on everybody. It's been difficult on us as a group, singing and traveling. You know, we've had cancellations and stuff like that, and I know that you guys have been shut down for an extended period of time, but I want you to know that God is not done. God's not done with this church. He's not done with this country. I believe that with my whole heart, that at any point, personally or as a country or as families or as a state or as a government, we can turn this ship around and turn it towards the Lord. Now, whether folks in leadership will or not, that's not for me to decide. But I do know this, that we have the ability and the opportunity to wake up every day and choose Jesus. Amen. We can wake up every day and choose to follow God. And it is a choice. It is a choice to follow the Lord. It's not always the easy thing to do, and it's not always the thing that may be the most popular thing to do, but it's always the right choice to follow Jesus. And so I just wanted you to know before I got started today that I love you, and that I've been praying for you over the last year, and we covet and appreciate your prayers as well. Today I'm going to be preaching a sermon that I've preached one other time, but I really felt the Lord was really felt the Lord was on me to preach this sermon again, and it comes out of 1 Kings, and it's about a man out of the Bible named Elijah. But before we get started, I want to ask you a few questions. And when I ask this, obviously you're not in the room, so you can't raise your hands or anything like that. But maybe where you're sitting or wherever you're watching, you can answer these questions. I don't want you to be shy about it. I don't want you to feel like you're boasting about yourself in it. I just want you to be honest. And because, you know, I'm going to ask you some questions maybe about, you know, what you're most confident in doing. And confident, I mean, what do you feel good about, the things that you can do? The Lord maybe has given you a gift, and what are the confident things that you can do? Some of these questions are like, you know, how many of the men feel pretty confident as a builder, right? We may have some men in the church that are confident builders. I know my dad seems like he can build anything, and I can build nothing. So that doesn't work out always in my favor. But my dad can build anything, and I don't understand how his brain works, and he doesn't understand how my brain works, and that's okay because we're different people, right? So what about music? My dad's not confident in music. I'm confident in music. My wife is confident in music. We're all different, right? What about cooks? Who's a confident cook? Some of the ladies may be confident cooks. I know Fred Tate is probably a really confident cook because he cooks a lot of the breakfasts and stuff here. And my papa cooks the best gravy in the world. So, you know, I'm sure he's confident in that. You know, there's all different types of things that we can be confident in. And all of the big accomplishments and things that we feel confident about in our lives have a similar requirement. And what I mean when I say that is, if you want to feel confident about something, if you want to feel good about how you perform doing a certain thing, there are two things that are prerequisites for confidence in your life, and that's experience and preparation. Those are the two things in your life that you have to have in order to be confident about a certain thing. You have to have experience in doing it, and you have to be prepared. You have to have preparation. So if you're going to build a house, right, it would be foolish to do it if you've never had experience in doing it. In other words, it would be really foolish for me to build a house because you wouldn't have much of a house. You would have something that didn't look like a house at all, most likely. But my dad, he has a lot of experience in building, and so he could feel that confidence. He has a lot of experience, and so he could feel very confident in building a house. You surely wouldn't try to build a house without first sitting down and estimating the cost, right? You've got to estimate the cost. You've got to make a list of supplies. You've got, and what are all those things doing? All those things are preparing you to be confident about the job that is at hand. All of those things. So the fact that you're experienced in building, and the fact that you've made the necessary preparations in order to make the supply lists and the timelines and all the things that are necessary to get the job done, that is what makes you confident when you step on the job site. Amen? That's what makes you feel confident, is that you have experience in what you're doing and that you have prepared to do the work. You've prepared to do the work. And so it's the same thing with anything else you do in your life. Like, you're not, the ladies aren't going to walk into the kitchen and start cooking a meal if they don't know how to turn the stove on, right? I mean, if you don't have any experience in cooking, then you probably, you know, before you can feel confident about cooking, you need to have some experience. And before, you know, you can't just go in there and throw whatever you want to in a pot and hope it turns out okay. You've got to be prepared and make sure that you have all the ingredients that are necessary to make that special recipe. It was the same thing when I was in college with music. You know, I had to be prepared for my classes, and I felt like I lived in a practice room, these little bitty rooms with these big pianos and a mirror. That was all that was in there. I felt like I lived in those rooms for 4 years. But I had to feel confident in my craft so that when I got out of school, I could do what I needed to do. And so I had to be prepared, and I had to have experience in what I was doing. And so I say all that to say this. It takes two things to be confident in whatever you set out to do, and that's experience and preparation. Now, spiritually speaking, it also takes experience and preparation in order to be confident in whatever it is in your life that you feel like God is asking you to do. You've got to be experienced, you've got to have some experience with God, and you've got to be prepared. You've got to allow God to prepare you. However, when we talk about spiritual confidence, we're not talking about confidence in ourselves, but we're talking about confidence, complete confidence in God. When you're talking about spiritual confidence, it's not a confidence in yourself, but a complete confidence in God. And so today I want to preach to you about a man in the Bible that had complete confidence in our God and why he had complete confidence in our God. And in order to have that, you must allow God to prepare you, and you must allow God to have experiences with you. And so this guy's name is Elijah, and I want to kind of set the scene for you. I want to set the scene for you why Elijah was so confident in God. Go ahead and turn to 1 Kings 17, but before we read it, I don't know if you know anything about Elijah's life, but Elijah, the story in the Bible that Elijah is most well known for is when he stood on Mount Carmel in the book of 1 Kings, and he was up against 450 prophets of Baal. I don't know if you remember that story or not, but the people of Israel had turned and they were worshiping this god named Baal. And they did all this idol worship to him, and basically God sends Elijah to Mount Carmel, and he's against all 450 prophets of Baal. And you got to remember something now: Elijah was by himself. He was the only prophet of God in the land. He was the only man that was listening to God. He was the only man that was really hearing from God. He was the only man that would stand on behalf of God and speak to the people. He was all by himself. And he goes up onto this mountaintop. And basically, he has a face-off with the prophets of Baal. That's what Elijah is most known for. And that's the story that's found in 1 Kings 18. That's in 1 Kings 18. And so all these prophets of Baal are gathered on Mount Carmel along with Elijah. And basically they say this. Here's what they say on top of the mountain. Elijah goes up on top of the mountain. He's by himself, 450 prophets of Baal. And they say, okay, we're going to decide who the real true God is today. We're going to decide, and we're going to decide through this competition. Okay? And so basically the rules of the competition were we're going to pray to our God, right? The prophets of Baal are going to pray to their God. And then Elijah will have his turn and pray to his God. They both built altars there, right, to their gods. And they're going to pray to their gods. And whoever calls down fire from heaven, in other words, whichever God sends fire down from heaven, then that's the God that they're going to worship. That's the God that they'll choose to worship. So if Baal sends the fire down, then they'll worship Baal. But if the true living God, the God of Elijah, sends the fire down, then they're going to worship the God of Elijah. And so that's where we are here at in 1 Kings 18. The rules of the competition are simple, right? It is a competition. It's the 450 prophets of Baal versus the one prophet of God. Now you would think that being outnumbered 450-1, right, that Elijah might be a little nervous. He might be a little intimidated, but you would be wrong. You see, not only was Elijah confident that his God would deliver, he was completely confident that Baal wouldn't. Why? Obviously, because Elijah knew that Baal wasn't even real. He was a false god. He wasn't even real. So, Here's how it happens. The prophets of Baal, they start running around, dancing around, cutting themselves with stones, and they're praying to Baal, asking him to send the fire down. Nothing's happening, of course. And so as those prophets of Baal begin to cry and yell and scream and cut themselves and pray, you don't see Elijah standing over in the corner somewhere wringing his hands. You don't see Elijah worried that Baal might rain down fire from heaven and that Jehovah, his God, might not rain down fire from heaven. In fact, Elijah starts mocking the prophets of Baal. You remember that? Elijah starts saying things like, oh, Baal's not answering. Maybe he can't hear you. Maybe he's off doing something else. Maybe he's asleep. Maybe he's busy with something else and he can't hear you. And maybe you should pray a little louder. So Elijah starts mocking these prophets of Baal. And obviously, Baal never rains down fire because he's not God. And so now it's Elijah's turn. Elijah prays a simple prayer. He prays a simple prayer to heaven. And God sends down fire from heaven. And it consumes the altar. And the Bible says that the prophets of Baal in that moment when they saw all that happen, they recognized that the God of Elijah was the true living God, and the people turned back to God. And what did they do? They took those 450 prophets of Baal down to the river and they slaughtered them all. They killed them all. And the people turned back to God. because Elijah was able to walk in confidence of who he knew his God to be. Elijah walked in confidence. Now I'd say that's a pretty good day for Elijah, right? I mean, the 450 prophets of Baal, Elijah shows up, everything's great, God calls down fire from heaven, and everything's really awesome in that moment, right? Because Elijah won, and the people turned back to God, and they killed the prophets of Baal. But why was Elijah able to walk in such confidence in God in 1 Kings 18? Why did Elijah know beyond the shadow of a doubt when he walked up Mount Carmel that God was going to deliver? How was he so confident that he was even able to mock the prophets of Baal in that moment? How was he so confident that he knew with one little prayer that God would call down fire from heaven? Because Elijah was so confident because he had been prepared by God for this ministry that he was doing on Mount Carmel in that moment. He was confident. Remember I said at the beginning, anything you do in your life, if you want to feel confident in it, you've got to have experience with it, and you've got to be prepared for it, right? And so Elijah, he was prepared for that ministry, that day of ministry. Elijah was prepared because of his experiences with God in 1 Kings 17. You see, 1 Kings 18, we see the big ordeal, right? We see this big battle on top of Mount Carmel, and Elijah's on top of the world, and he's won the battle, and the people return to God. And like I said, you know, they kill the prophets of Baal, and Elijah's just walking with such confidence that day, and he knows that his God is real, and he's worshiping God, and everything's great. But what we don't know, what we don't see, what we don't study sometimes are all the things that Elijah went through in 1 Kings 17 to be able to walk in the confidence that he walked in 1 Kings 18. Amen? And the reason why, we're going to get to this in just a second, the reason why that Elijah was able to walk in such confidence is because he was prepared through experiences with God. Let me say that one more time. Elijah was prepared through experiences with God. And so here's what I want to do. I want to read 1 Kings 17. Now this is not the part of the scripture that everybody knows about Elijah. Some people probably do. But this is the part of the scripture that I want to study with you today. Let me get it pulled up here just a second. Sorry. 1 Kings 17. Now, y'all hang with me here. Don't turn off YouTube just yet, okay? Hang with me here. Let me finish. It says, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, who was the king at the time, 'As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall be no dew or rain these years, but according to my word.'" So in other words, at this point, Elijah comes to King Ahab and says, because of the wickedness of the people, there will be a drought in the land. There will be a drought. No, it's not going to rain, until I say it will rain, right? "And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, 'Get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook. I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there.' So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, 'Arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee.' So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, 'Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink.' And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, 'Bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand.' And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and after make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Now there's much more to that story. There's much more that goes on in chapter 17. Like at one point, the widow's son that he was staying with dies, and Elijah takes him up into the upper chambers of the house, and he actually brings him back to life. And there's all kinds of things in this story that we could go into, but we'd be here all night, and I know you don't want that. And so, but what I do want to mention to you here is this. At this point, Elijah is the only prophet of God. And he goes to King Ahab, as we read in this scripture. He goes to King Ahab and he says this, look, there's going to be a drought in the land. The people have turned against God and there's going to be a drought in the land. Then immediately, what does God do? God sends him into the wilderness. He sends him away, he sends him into the wilderness, and he sends him down by this brook. Right? And Elijah begins to drink of the brook, and the ravens, they bring him a meal in the morning and they bring him a meal at night. And I'm sure that Elijah was sitting there thinking to himself, now, Lord, I'm the only one in the land that will speak up for you. I'm the only one that will work for you. I'm the only one that loves you. Now, why are you doing this to me? Why are you sending me away? Why are you sending me out to the wilderness to be fed by ravens and drink by the brook? I mean, this would be like God sending, you know, the prince of preachers down into the wilderness, you know, for no apparent reason. And so Elijah doesn't understand, but he goes down into this wilderness, and every day he had no idea why God was sending him there, and he thought it was the exact wrong place to be, but God knew it was the right place to be. You know why? Because God was giving Elijah the confidence that he needed. He was preparing Elijah for the day of ministry that he needed him to do in 1 Kings 18 on top of Mount Carmel by sending him to the wilderness. And you say, how did he do that? Well, every day that he sat down there by that brook and those ravens brought him that food in the morning and he brought them that food at night, Elijah knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that he was 100% completely reliant on the Lord. There was no way in the world that Elijah could ever get by unless those ravens showed up every morning and unless those ravens showed up every evening. And you and I must understand that we are 100,000% reliant on the Lord. And sometimes God has to send us into the wilderness in order for us to get that. Every day Elijah had to drink from that brook. He was completely reliant on the Lord. And that's what God wanted in that moment. You see, Elijah was being prepared by God. In that moment, he was being prepared by God through experiences with God. He had to experience that time in the wilderness so that when he walked up onto Mount Carmel that day in 1 Kings 18 and he was outnumbered and he was backed up against the wall and all the odds looked stacked against him, he knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that God was going to come through. Why? Because every day for so many years, God fed him and he gave him everything he needed right down there by the brook. And you can walk in confidence today. You see, there's a lot of questions out there right now. And I'll be honest with you, there are times where I have trust issues with people. I have trust issues with situations in my life. But I'm going to tell you this much. I know I can trust God. You say, how do you know that? I know I can trust God because I've never went without. I know I can trust God because He's always provided for me. I know that I can trust my God because He's always come through on my behalf. I can look back at His track record and know that my God is able and know that my God will provide for me in everything that I may need. Amen? And that's why Elijah could charge up Mount Carmel that day. But you see, it didn't end there. It didn't end there. Because after the brook, remember there was a drought. That's why all this happened to begin with. Elijah, he received a word from the Lord that the drought was coming. The drought came, so Elijah had to go down into the wilderness. Well, then eventually, because there was no rain, obviously, the brook that he was drinking from dried up. So I'm sure he's like, well, now what, Lord? And God sends him to a city called Zarephath. I don't know if you know anything about that city. It was a pagan city. And He sends him to live with a widow woman. I didn't think that was too big of a, you know, deal or whatever, but apparently widowed women were on the lowest rung of the socioeconomic class. In other words, they were the lowest of the low in that day. And so God sends His man, He sends His prophet to live with a widowed woman. So Elijah goes. She doesn't even have enough meal or oil to feed him. She said, we're going to go in here and make one final meal, basically, and me and my son are going to die. And I'm sure Elijah was wondering, Lord, why? Why are you sending me here? But He said, go and get me a drink of water and make me a cake first, and I promise you that God will provide for you. And every day that he lived with that woman, they woke up. Do you get it? They woke up every day and witnessed and experienced a miracle in their kitchen. Every day. Because every time she'd reach down in that barrel, she'd pull out just enough meal to make their food. And every time there was just enough oil left in the jar for her to make one more meal. Every day they witnessed a miracle every single day. Now, why is that important? That's important because Elijah needed to experience that. Elijah needed to see that God could come through not just for a little while, but that God could come through every day for his every meal, miraculously every day. So you say, well, how do you walk in such confidence? The only way you can have confidence is to be prepared and to have experience in anything in life. And that's the only reason Elijah was confident when he walked up on Mount Carmel once again, was because he was confident because he had experiences with God and he was prepared through experiences with God. Every day he sat in that kitchen and he witnessed her reach her hand down in that jar and have just enough, and reach her hand down in that barrel and have just enough. And Elijah knew that God was always going to take care of him. And you've got to know today that no matter what comes your way, no matter what you're struggling with today, no matter what you're going through, and the good Lord knows that we're all going through stuff right now. The good Lord knows that we're all struggling right now, that America is divided. Our country is divided. Our churches are divided. And it seems like things are falling apart. But you've got to know today that you can walk in confidence. You can walk in confidence because of God's track record in your own life. You can walk in confidence today knowing that the worst thing that's going to happen is you're going to die and go to heaven and be with Jesus if you know Him. That you can walk in confidence today because you've experienced God. You can walk in confidence today because you have been prepared through experiences with God. Now let me say this and I'm going to come to a close. Do you realize that after Elijah called for the drought, and then immediately God sent him to the wilderness, and he was there for a while till the brook dried up, and then he was sent to the widow's home, and then after that, that's when he went and did his thing in 1 Kings 18 on top of Mount Carmel. Do you realize that the time in between him calling the drought and the time of the day on Mount Carmel was like 3.5 years? 3.5 years. So that is significant in this way. It took God 3.5 years to prepare Elijah for one day of ministry on Mount Carmel. 3.5 years for one day of ministry. So I don't know what God is asking you to do. I don't know what God has for you in your life, but look at me. God has a plan for your life. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." Now I know it's been tough. I know it's still tough. But here's the thing. Day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, Elijah watched God provide for him. He watched God take care of him in the deepest, darkest hours of his life. And so he had confidence. He could walk in confidence, knowing that God was going to take care of him no matter what he saw up there on Mount Carmel. So you may feel like today that it's 450 against one. You may feel like today that you're backed up against the wall. You may feel like today that you're just cornered and surrounded by the enemy. You may feel attacked spiritually by the enemy and his demons and all those that are just so mean, people that are just mean and hateful and just, I don't even know how to say it, just nasty and vile and arrogant and prideful, and it seems like the world is just falling apart. Well, I've come to give you good news today. You can be encouraged today that God is there, that God is not going anywhere. You can walk in confidence today. You can walk in confidence knowing that God is going to always take care of you because you're His child. And He provided and He walked with Elijah every step of the way. And He's going to walk with you. And He's going to be there for you. And He's going to provide for you. Now, it didn't come the way that Elijah thought it would come. And it may not come the way that you think it's going to come. But sometimes God has to send us into the wilderness so that we can experience Him and be prepared for the ministry that He's called us to do, for the next step that God's asking us to take. And so I'd say this to you in closing. What's God asking of you today? I mean, really, you know, if there's ever been a time that we need to stop playing games with God, it's right now. It's not a time to play games with God. It's not a time to make this thing about church or religion. Are you walking with God? Because if you're not, you will fail. You will fall. You will falter. You need Him. You need to be confident in Him. You can't be confident in yourself because you'll fail. I fail. We all fail. We all mess it up. We all screw it up. But you can walk in confidence because God never fails. He never gives up. He loves you. He'll support you. He'll pursue you. He'll chase after you. And so in closing today, I just want to ask you, where are you with God today? Do you trust Him? Do you really trust Him? Can you walk in confidence in God today? Or are you fearful? I understand that. There have been times through all this mess that I've been fearful. But I've had to remind myself and remind myself over and over and over that I can be confident in the Lord because He's prepared me. Through all the experiences that I've had with Him, He's prepared me for such a time as this. And it's time that the church steps up in such a time as this. Run to Jesus. Give Him everything you have. Allow Him to use you. I love you so much. And I really appreciate the opportunity. I don't get to preach very often. And I appreciate the opportunity. I'll say this and I'm going to pray over you and we'll be done. Don't allow the devil or anybody else to intimidate you. When Elijah was up on Mount Carmel, he could have been very intimidated by all those prophets of Baal. But Elijah prayed one simple prayer, called down fire from heaven. And those prophets of Baal, they prayed and prayed and prayed and screamed and prayed and screamed and prayed for hours. Nothing ever happened. Don't be intimidated by the enemy. Don't be intimidated by those that would come against you. Don't walk in fear of those that would come against you. Don't walk in fear of a virus. Be careful, but don't walk in fear. You can be confident in God today. I love you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. God, I thank you, Lord, that we can have complete confidence in you because of the experiences that we've had with you and your track record. And so, God, you prepare us for what you've prepared us for what we're going through now. You're preparing us now for what we're going to go through in the future. And God, I know that it's hard right now, it's difficult, but Lord, I just pray that we'll rise up, that we won't tuck our tails and run, that we won't walk in defeat, that we won't walk in fear, but we'll walk in victory because you are our victor and you've saved us and you've changed us and we can be confident in you. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. We pray that it maybe help someone today. I know it's helped me over the years, this word. So God, I just pray that you'll move and work in the hearts and lives of your people. Thank you, God, for all that you do for us. Help us to walk in victory today. Help us to walk in confidence in today. Not in ourselves, but in you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.